بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I had an interesting question come in. Somebody wants to know that is there any proofs or evidences in the Quran or the Hadith about the permissibility of making dhikr in a gathering? They said they love to attend these gatherings, except that sometimes they will hear people say these are innovations and bid'ah, and then they get filled with doubt, and then they stop attending them, and then something happens, they miss it, and they go back. So, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, this is a very good question. And being concerned about bid'ah is actually from iman, because the Prophet ﷺ warned us about innovations, and he said ﷺ, kullu bid'atin dalala wa kulli dalalatin fin nar. Every innovation is a misguidance, and every misguidance leads to the hellfire. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for protection from every bid'ah. Now, as far as dhikr is concerned, dhikr is one of the foundational acts of worship in Islam. Dhikr Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded in the Quran, and every act of worship can be considered dhikr, including salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ لِلذِّكْرِ. Establish the salah for my dhikr. And also the Quran itself, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls it dhikr. You know, we have revealed, we have sent down the dhikr. And the people of knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls them people of dhikr. فَاسْأَلُوا أَحْلِ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. So that being said, dhikr, we understand it to extend across every act of worship that is done with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some of the acts of worship, of course, is done, you know, with the fara'id that the Prophet ﷺ have commanded us. Allah has made injunction upon us. Some of them are additional, optional things that the Prophet ﷺ encouraged, and the Quran also encouraged. So let's look at these things. Now, for a person who wants to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we look at the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ in a hadith called the Hadith of the Wali. The Prophet ﷺ said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is Hadith Qudsi, that whoever shows hostility, whoever shows enmity, whoever is rude to my wali, I declare war against them. So in other words, anyone who goes against the wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anyone who speaks ill of them, or he thinks ill of them, or does anything evil to them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basically saying, don't mess with my people. Don't mess with my people, because I'll have their back. Now, who are these people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lays out the path to us. My servants does not draw closer to me except by doing what's obligatory. So the first act of dhikr that we establish, that we do, is the dhikr of the obligatory things. Right? The obligatory things includes the salawat, the five daily prayers, fasting in Ramadan, giving the zakat. All of those things is an act of dhikr, right? And as you start to perfect those things, then there is the optional things. The Prophet ﷺ recommended certain things to certain sahaba that he didn't to others. You know, depending on your level of aspiration, depending on your himmah, Prophet ﷺ would give to some sahaba what he didn't give to others. So then the Prophet ﷺ says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, then my servant draws closer to me by doing optional things, additional things. The optional things, the additional things, now this is what gets you beyond the barrier of being a natural, you know, worshipper, a regular worshipper, from being in the circle of the servitude to being in the circle of the beloveds. Yeah, until I love him. My servant continues to draw close to me by doing the optional things until I love him. And when I love him, until the rest of the hadith, right? So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you, then you're a wali, that's it. And Allah is generous. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. So this hadith indicates to us that there are degrees with which we approach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there's etiquettes. The etiquettes start with, you know, observing the fara'id first, and then moving over to the optional things. Now, the optional things include making dhikr, extra dhikr. Everyone has to make one time dhikr in their life, which is the shahada. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. This one, the one that we say, we have to do it at least once to be Muslims, right? Beyond that, our ulama said, if you do it once every day, if you do it in every prayer, it's better for you. And then others said, if you want to attain even closer, then you can do more. You can do more. And not just that, you can get together in groups to encourage each other. So anything that's done in a group has greater merits, greater reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than if you do it by yourself. Because now you're doing amr bil ma'ruf, you're encouraging the good by engaging in it together. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Encourage each other to the haqq and encourage each other to patience, right? So this is done by being in a community, being with people, doing things together. And dhikr is no different. And there are many, many proofs in the hadith in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us, because hadith Qudsi, about the merits of making dhikr in a gathering. So for example, in hadith Qudsi, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I am in the opinion of my servant. So Allah says, I am in the opinion of my servant. What does that mean? Whatever you think about Allah, whatever your opinion of Allah is, whatever you expect from Allah, Allah is that to you, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat you the way you expect him to treat you. And then he said, if he remembers, and I am with him when he remembers me. So as soon as you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is present with you, right? And then he says, if he remembers me to himself, I remember him to myself. So if you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making mention of you to himself. If he remembers me in a gathering, so if you're in a gathering and you're saying Allah together, you're saying La ilaha illallah together, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I remember him in a gathering better than it. So our ulama said, this is a proof you can make dhikr in a gathering, because if he makes dhikr in a gathering, right? Another hadith, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has angels whose job is to seek out gatherings of zikr. Right? They search the lands, they search the earth, and they look for gatherings of zikr. And when they find one, to them it looks like a shining star in the night, in the beautiful clear night. And then when they find one, the Prophet ﷺ said, they encircle them and then fold their wings, stretching all the way out to the heavens until they enter the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says, where are you coming from? They say, we're coming from this place. And Allah says, what's happening there? And Allah knows better. Right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is putting emphasis on, because the angels are excited to report this. So the angels say, oh ya Allah, there are people who've gathered together making dhikr of you. They're saying subhanallah, they're saying alhamdulillah, they're saying la ilaha illallah, they're saying Allahu Akbar, right? And they're seeking for protection from Jahannam. They're asking you for Jannah. Allah will say, have they seen Jannah? They say, no, they haven't. You know, what if they saw it? Right? Man, they would be in a different state. Have they seen hellfire? No, they haven't. What if they saw it? They would be in a different state. So Allah says, I make you witnesses that I forgive all of them. La ilaha illallah. I forgive all of them. And not just that, he says, and I will give them what they're asking for, and I protect them from what they're seeking refuge in. In other words, guaranteed everything. La ilaha illallah. Because you're in that gathering. Because the Prophet ﷺ called it meadows of Jannah. Another hadith, we'll talk about it. So the angels, they object. They say, ya Allah, there is one person there. He's not one of them. He's forced to be there. Somebody brought him by force. You know, Allah says, even him I forgive. Because these are people, no one who sits with them is deprived. La ilaha illallah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he encouraged active dhikr. And he encouraged these gatherings. He said sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when you come across one of the meadows of Jannah, graze therein. Graze. Take your time. You know, enjoy it. They said, ya Rasulullah, what are these meadows of Jannah? He said, halaqas of dhikr, halaqas of dhikr. Some people, they argue, yeah, but in the time of the Prophet ﷺ, they didn't come together and call out Allah, Allah. How do you know that? There's a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ and the Sahaba were calling out to Allah, ya Allah, ya Allah, ya Allah. Prophet ﷺ said, not too loud, because you're not calling on the one who doesn't hear. Not too loud, you're not calling on the one who doesn't hear. Meaning, you know, pace yourself. don't lose your voice. Allah can hear you. La ilaha illallah. So the Sahaba, they did this. And they had their own dhikr in group when they're traveling. When they're going uphill, they would say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar together in one voice. When they're traveling downhill, they would say Subhanallah, Subhanallah together. This is dhikr in together. You know, there's nothing wrong with it. Another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that verily no people sit together and make dhikr of Allah except that angels encircle them. Right? And then some people, they like to downplay this by saying the Prophet ﷺ entered the masjid and he saw a halaqa of dhikr and he saw a halaqa of ilm. And he sat with the people of ilm. So they say, therefore, it's not good to have a halaqa of dhikr, better to have halaqa of ilm. Ya akhi, the Prophet ﷺ sat with the people of knowledge. Because he's a prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he's the dispenser of knowledge. When he sits in a gathering, do you think anyone else will speak? It's the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who will teach, who will speak. So he sat with them because he saw somebody else sitting with the people of dhikr. La ilaha illallah. So it's not to discount the acts of dhikr. It's to show you that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he acknowledged it, he didn't stop them, and he went and he started, you know, performing his duties as a Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because these guys already, they're making dhikr. It all falls under the framework of what's permissible. And so whoever tells you this thing is innovation, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our knowledge. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us to the straight path. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to not make us of those who are deprived. Because if you're not sitting with the people of dhikr, you're deprived. But if you're sitting with them, even if you don't belong there, alhamdulillah, you get the barakah just by being there. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.